especially a welcome to everyone who is joining us online. God be with you all. We will begin our service with hymn 438, A Lamb Goes Uncomplaining Forth. And then after that, we will continue with responsive prayer 2 on page 285. So we begin with hymn 438.
Oh,
Please stand. O Lord, open my lips,
and my mouth will declare your praise.
Make haste, O God, to deliver me.
Make haste to help me, O Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Praise to you, O Christ, Lamb of our salvation. We pray Psalm 94 responsively by whole verse. We pray it by speaking it responsively. O Lord, God of vengeance, O God of vengeance, shine forth.
Rise up, O Judge, appear. Repay to the proud what they deserve.
O Lord, how long shall the wicked, how long shall the wicked exult?
They pour out their arrogant words, all the evildoers boast.
They crush your people, O Lord, and afflict your heritage.
They kill the widow and the sojourner, and murder the fatherless.
And they say, the Lord does not see, the God of Jacob does not perceive.
Understand, O dullest of the people, fools, when will you be wise?
He who planted the ear, does he not hear? He who formed the eye, does he not see?
He who disciplines the nations, does he not rebuke? He who teaches man knowledge.
The Lord knows the thoughts of man, that they are but a breath.
Blessed is the man whom you discipline, Lord, and whom you teach out of your law.
To give him rest from days of trouble until a pit is dug for the wicked.
For the Lord will not forsake his people. He will not abandon his heritage.
For justice will return to the righteous, and all the upright in heart will follow it.
Who rises up for me against the wicked? Who stands up for me against evildoers?
If the Lord had not been my help, my soul would have lived in the land of silence.
When I thought my foot slips, your steadfast love, O Lord, held me up.
When the cares of my heart are many, your consolations cheer my soul.
Can wicked rulers be allied with you, those who frame injustice by statutes?
They band together against the life of the righteous and condemn the innocent to death.
But the Lord has become my stronghold, and my God the rock of my refuge.
He will bring back on them their iniquity and wipe them out for their wickedness. The Lord our God will wipe them out. Be seated. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Matthew, the 27th chapter. As they went out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his garments among them by casting lots. Then they sat down and kept watch over him there. And over his head they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." So also the chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him, saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now, if he desires him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" And the robbers who were crucified with him also reviled him in the same way. Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is, my God, why have you forsaken me? And some of the bystanders, hearing it, said, This man is calling Elijah. And one of them at once ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, and put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink. But the others said, Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come and save him. And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. And behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook, and the rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the tombs after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. When the centurion and those who were with him, keeping watch over Jesus, saw the earthquake and what took place, they were filled with awe and said, Truly, this was the Son of God. There were also many women there looking on from a distance, who had followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering to him, among whom were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who also was a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him. And Joseph took the body and wrapped it in a clean linen shroud, and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had cut in the rock. And he rolled a great stone to the entrance of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the tomb. Next day, that is, after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, Sir, we remember how that impostor said while he was still alive, After 3 days I will rise. Therefore order the tomb to be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples go and steal him away and tell the people he has risen from the dead. And the last fraud will be worse than the first. Pilate said to them, You have a guard of soldiers. Go, make it as secure as you can. So they went and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone and setting a guard. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We continue with hymn 878, Abide With Me.
Thank you.
indebted for today's sermon to Pastor Dwayne Bombs of Grace Grass Valley, who gave me the outline and the content, basically, for today's sermon. Our text is Psalm 94. In Jesus' name, amen. So, how are you doing with this so-called invisible enemy? I mean, the spread of the coronavirus, you know, is unseen and unknown. Social distancing, or, you know, spatial distancing, seems to be just another enemy. It keeps us away from grandchildren and grandparents and friends and brothers and sisters in Christ. This feels like our wrestling with the cosmic powers of this present darkness that Paul talks about in Ephesians. And this is just one of the enemies. How do the faithful live in a world where all evil seems to triumph, and triumph so easily? I mean, doesn't our Almighty God hear our prayers? Can our Lord Yahweh do something about our enemies? How is it that we can put up with this? Even the psalmist is despondent. Oh Lord, how long shall the wicked exult? The problem with our enemies is very similar to the problem of suffering that we heard about a few weeks ago. And eventually the solution is the same. Even so, we are terribly short-sighted about both of these problems. We constantly think in terms of today, tomorrow, or maybe next week, without considering the enormity of all eternity and the immensity of the mind of God, the King of the universe. Do your enemies really truly get by with it in the end? It sure seems like it. The problem is that evil and enemies so often seem to succeed over good Christian people. And we have lied to ourselves so many times, thinking that God is going to bless his people all the time. Oh yeah, we think that God will continually do good to his people, and he'll do it often. But it doesn't work out that way, does it? Christians suffer. They suffer sometimes terribly and for long periods of time. And it seems like the Almighty God does not hear our prayers, that he's abandoned you in your pain, abandoned you in continuous attacks of your enemies. The psalmist does say, oh Lord, how long shall the wicked exult? And you go in there and nod your head right along with them. Yeah, Lord, how long will they rejoice? But even in the outcry of the psalmist, you heard it when you said that song. It's framed in trust. Our God and Lord must act according to his promises. Our God, our Father, cannot break his own covenant, and so he cannot forsake his own. The psalmist reminds himself, and he reminds you, our Lord will not forsake his people. He will not abandon his heritage. When you're suffering at the hands of your enemies, this invisible enemy, when evil appears to triumph over you and yours, and when everything seems lost, remember the Lord your God. See things through the lens of his teaching, of his word, his person, and his nature. Then and only then will you see eternity is greater than time itself. Eternity swallows up all of known history, the millennia of humanity in one tiny gulp. I know, in the moment, Christians don't see that. In our sinful nature, it just keeps us focused right here and now. What's in front of us? And the need to win right now destroys our faith and our trust in the Lord. Yet, the faith given to you by God our Father is what triumphs in the end. It is the gift of grace and salvation and the place prepared for you with the Lord that you trust for your peace. This is the sound of silence. This is the sound that we often hear from God. His seeming silence and inaction is why the psalmist complains, "They crush your people, O Lord, and afflict your heritage. They kill the widow and the sojourner and murder the fatherless." And they say, "The Lord does not see. The God of Jacob does not perceive." See, God, they are not even worried about you. They don't even think you exist. And you can't punish them. You can't do anything. So why do you do it this way, God? Why do they always win? But they don't win, do they? It helps to remember our small catechism here. In the Lord's Prayer, we pray, "Deliver us from evil," or the evil one. And Luther says, in part, we pray that our Father in heaven would rescue us from every evil of body and soul. And when our final day comes, give us a blessed end and take us away from this valley of sorrow to himself in heaven. But who is this God who rains down vengeance on evil? Who is this God who's going to take care of our enemies? That's the problem, isn't it? In your laments, you want God to just thunder his voice and terrify your enemies. You want him to just crush your enemies with his outstretched arm and mighty hand. And you want him to do it right now. But that's not the God that we've come to learn about and to know, is it? When the psalmist complains, he doesn't complain to that hidden God who no one can see. He complains to the God of the covenant, the God who fulfills his promises. And where are those promises fulfilled? Where is the victory proclaimed and won? Where is the God who triumphs for you? Where is your champion? The search for all of those answers ends in the splintered wood of Golgotha, that blood-soaked cross upon which your champion, your Lord Christ, reveals his power and wisdom and glory in his very own broken body and spilled blood given for you. There's no way of knowing why one person and not another suffers, or why the enemies of God's people triumph against the faithful. But you don't need to question God, for he has shown decisively there on the cross that he fights for you, and he is not against you. How can evil ultimately triumph over you with God on your side? We're reminded in his word, if God is for us, who is against us? How can the gates of hell prevailed against the church when her champion has destroyed death and the devil themselves. Yet even when faith is weak, dim, smoldering like a dying candle flame, the faithful can trust God in their sufferings and remain confident of God's favor. So even though you're oppressed in this life, even though evil seems to win, even though evil seems to triumph over you, you are safe and you are secure in the Lord your God, not only in the present, but also into eternity. The crucified and dead Christ assures you that you have won the victory over all evil and your enemies. The problem of my enemies is solved in Christ the crucified for you, for his death and his resurrection. They are destroyed and condemned to hell for eternity, and you and all the faithful, the multitudes of millions, enter into the eternal courts with thanksgiving and praise and victory, clothed in the blood of the Lamb for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. This time I would like to encourage all of our members who are dispersed to please consider their giving either electronically or by mail. We rise for prayer. O Lord,
have mercy.
O Christ,
have mercy.
O Lord,
have mercy.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Hear my prayer, O Lord.
Let my cry come to you.
In the day of my trouble, I call upon you.
For you answer me.
Hide your face from my sins.
And blot out all my iniquities.
Create in me a clean heart, O God.
And renew a right spirit within me.
Cast me not away from your presence.
And take not your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation.
And uphold me with the willing spirit.
Because your steadfast love is better than life.
My lips will praise you.
For you have been my help.
And in the shadow of your wings I will sing for joy.
Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth.
Unite my heart to fear your name.
I give thanks to you, O Lord my God, with my whole heart.
And I will glorify your name forever.
May all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you.
May those who love your salvation say evermore, God is great.
Save your people and bless your heritage.
Be their shepherd and carry them forever.
Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer.
Listen to my plea for grace.
In our prayers today, we pray for all of those who are having surgery or recovering from surgery today, including Lori, Lynn, and Raquel. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, in your ministry, you healed many with frail and diseased bodies. Be present with Lori, Lynn, and Raquel as they undergo surgery. Bless them with faith in your loving kindness and protection. Endow the surgeons and the medical team with skill and alertness so that this surgery may help your servant to a speedy restoration of health and strength according to your gracious will. Hear us for your name's sake as you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless us, defend us from all evil, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. The final hymn is hymn number 422.